and you have n spheres. And the idea is that you want to put those spheres inside the box in such a way that they do not overlap. Okay. So here you have a control parameter that is just a packing fraction. So this is the volume, total volume occupied by the spheres. Divided by the total volume. And of course, if this phi is small, it means that the system is at low density. And then you can increase the density by increasing phi. So what you expect is that this problem, so as a function of phi, has two regimes. One is a regime where essentially the density is so small that if you more or less put the spheres at random, they do not overlap. And then there is a hard regime. Okay. Hard, maybe impossible here. Certainly impossible, when if phi is too big, if you take phi equal 1, then you will have to create overlaps, okay? And so what happens in the middle? Now, this problem is very old, and I mean, people like Gauss studied it a lot. And let me tell you what we know from a mathematical point of view, which is an interesting perspective. So imagine that I take monodisperse spheres. So here I take all spheres with radius 1. Of course, you can take spheres with different radii. So for monodisperse spheres, so we know, for example, that this transition can happen within a crystalline phase in low enough dimension. For example, in d equal 2, you know what's the densest packing that you can make in such a way that the spheres don't overlap. So you have the hexagonal lattice. So in d equal 3, again, we know the FCC lattice. And it was proven in 2004. And the proof is very involved. And it was proven by Ailes. Then we don't know more or less anything up to d equal 8. And this was proven, so was obtained, the densest packing was proven by Marina Wiatkowska in 2017, and she got the Fields Medal for this. And after her proof, so they adapted the proof to the case d equal 28. So this is the, 24, not 28. And this was, so here it's the E8 lattice. So that's the crystal. And d equal 24, you have what is called Rich lattice. And it was proven by Kohn, Kumar, Miller, Radchenko, and Wiatkowska again. Okay, so that's what we know about the densest packing in these dimensions. Of course, you can do simulations, and people have done. And there is an interesting question, what happens when D diverges? And this problem has interesting connections to coding theory, for example. So there are some connections in coding theory. And there is a nice review that I want just to highlight by Henry Cohn. And it's, I give you the archive reference. So it's archive. And there is also another interesting connection to apparently quantum gravity, and there are some works by Rattazzi, Mazzacci, and others. But don't ask me what's the details of this, because I'm still trying to learn them. So in general, the problem in infinite dimension is very complicated because you don't know if there is the solution to the densest packing is a kind of crystalline lattice. People believe that it's amorphous. And that's why, this is, for example, one reason why you would like to learn or to study amorphous packings in large dimensions. So that's what we know from the mathematical point of view. But of course, so this is a problem. You can try to solve it in a kind of algorithmic way. So how do you do? So imagine that you want to solve this problem in any dimension, okay? So from now on, I will assume that, for example, I have a polydispersed system, because I can say, okay, I take a bunch of spheres and I assign them a radius that can vary, so I extract the radii from a probability distribution function. And there, I mean, all group theory is lost. So you need to find a way to solve this problem somehow algorithmically. So how do you do? So the first strategy is to run some gradient descent. And this is essentially done in the work, the fundamental work by O'Hearn, Silbert, Liu and Nagel, 2003. So what do? So you start from defining some gap variables. So I denote by xi and xj the centers of spheres I and j. So these are d-dimensional vectors. And then I remove the radii. So this is positive if I have two spheres that do not overlap. And this is negative as soon as they overlap. Okay. So you define the gap. And then you define some cost function. Sorry?
And the radii are random variables.
You can extract them from a probability distribution function. You can take a B-dispersed system as you want. So here it's really an algorithm. So this is the input is the radii of the particles, the volume of the box, and the number of particles that you have. So that's your data. And then you can, so the question is find a satisfiable assignment for the position of the particles. So you define a cost function, an Hamiltonian, which is just the sum over all pairs of spheres. And then here you put a cost that depends on the gap. And you want a cost that is positive as soon as the gap is negative. And the cost must be zero as soon as you have a satisfiable assignment, so if the gap are positive. So what are, question? No. Okay. So what are possible choices for this cost? Okay. So all of them depend on the form of this function here. So the simplest one is the harmonic cost. So you pay energy as soon as the gap is negative, and you pay an energy that is quadratic in the gap. Okay, so these are harmonic spheres. you can have other possible choices, for example, V of H, that is H. Again, you pay energy as soon as the gap are negative. And these are Hertzian spheres. But you can have other possibilities. One interesting possibility is what we call linear spheres. So I pay the absolute value of the gap as soon as the gap is negative. And we call these linear spheres. Or you can even have, OK, I've right here, the case in which I take, which is infinite as soon as the spheres overlap, and zero when they do not overlap. OK, and these are hard spheres. Now, these, and these are functions that are not differentiable in one point, so when h is equal to 0. So for the moment, let me forget them. And let me consider this, those ones. Those functions are enough smooth. So since you want to find a solution to your problem, what you can do is to try to run some gradient descent on this cost. So you say, OK, let me try to find the position. Yes? It's just a way, it's just the interaction between particles. So the power laws that you put there is
square
the,
with a gap and
sorry?
Square with a gap and half with a gap.
This is just an harmonic cost, so it's an elastic,
okay,
and this is a bit non-linear, a bit more than elastic. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so there are some materials that in the dense phase can be modeled as this. But for me, now it's just a cost function that I want to choose in order to solve my constraint satisfaction problem. So what you can do is that you try to run some gradient descent. What do? You initialize the position of the spheres inside the box at random, and then you try to minimize the energy. Okay. So this is an algorithm. Where do you stop? You stop when the gradient is less than some tolerance. Okay. So this will give you an endpoint configuration. And then you can look at the energy of this endpoint configuration as a function of the packing fraction. And so what do you observe? Okay. So what do you observe? So one thing that you can plot is the probability that if I start from a random configuration and I run this algorithm, the endpoint energy is zero. So if the endpoint energy is zero, it means that I found a satisfiable configuration for the spheres. So you expect that when the packing fraction is very small, this p is essentially one. Okay, so I call this p sat. So it's the probability that if I take a configuration at random and I minimize the energy with this gradient descent, I get to zero energy. So if phi is small, this is 1, essentially. And then it should go to 0 as soon as increase phi. And then you can repeat this experiment for larger and larger systems. And the curves that you obtain are like this. So this is for small system size. And then if you increase the system size, you get something like this. OK. And so this is increasing n. Increasing system size, and then you need to increase the volume as well in order to keep phi to be constant at a given point. And so you have a transition here, that separates a phase in which that I call the satisfiable phase, where I'm able in the infinite in the thermodynamic limit to find a satisfiable assignment for the positions, and a phase that is unsatisfiable, where essentially I'm not able to find a configuration without any overlap. And this is this phase diagram, it's not a phase diagram, so this plot, it really depends on this algorithm, okay? So in particular in 3D, in 2D and 3D, so if I look at 5J, so this is around 0.84 in D equal 2, 0.64 in D equal 3. Okay, but you can repeat the experiment. Yes? No, you can take, I'm not talking about our spheres because our sphere I cannot take the derivative of the energy because you see it's not differentiable. So I'm taking this. So in particular, I think in the paper by these people, they consider this and this. Okay, yes?
In the right side of the plot?
Yes? Yes, here you get something like this. And here, so in this region here, sorry, you get something like this. Actually, when you run gradient descent, the gradient descent ends up in configuration in which you have something like pairs of spheres that just touch. Okay, and this is just because you have designed a cost function that has this form. Okay. So now you look at the configurations here, and then they form some space structure like this, which is not ordered. So there is no crystalline order if, for example, your radii are random, or the dimension is larger than 3, so that you are not able to nucleate the crystal. And so you have a kind of random structure, which is interesting. Okay. So this is a kind of algorithmic way to solve the constraint satisfaction problem. And now you would like to make a theory for this. And the theory for this is very hard. It's very complicated. Why? Because this is an algorithm that is a kind of out of equilibrium algorithm. There is no Gibbs measure that you can use to say something on the long time limit of the algorithm. And moreover, the problem is finite dimensional. So in general, you would like to study the problem in finite dimension. So I'm not aware of any theoretical tool that I can use to solve this particular problem. So this is complicated. But it turns out that the properties of those packings here are kind of universal. So they show some universal behavior that, for example, does not depend on the particular power that you put there. And those properties I will try to introduce a bit later. And I will focus a lot on them. So before turning to the universal properties of these packings, let me change a bit the algorithm. So I presented you some kind of heuristic algorithm. This is really a greedy algorithm to solve the problem. But you can do something a bit more involved. So I think I erase here. So what you can do is that you say, OK, so this is very greedy. So I'm really trying to minimize some cost function. And maybe this is suboptimal. Suppose that I would like to maximize this density. So I would like to maximize the SAT region. So how do you do? Well, you use Lubacevsky-Stillinger algorithm. And now we'll which is nothing but what people in computer science call simulated annealing. From an early work by Kirkpatrick. Gelat and Vecchi. So what do you do? So imagine that I want to maximize this phi. So what I can do is that I can start from low phi, where it's very easy to find configurations with no overlapping spheres. And then I can try to increase phi, okay, in a kind of controlled way. So in order to do this, since I would like to maximize phi j, what I can do is to start directly from hard spheres. So hard spheres, if you think about them, so if I have a configuration of hard spheres, this is a solution of my problem, because hard spheres cannot overlap. So I start with hard spheres at very low phi, and then I keep the potential to be hard spheres, and I start to increase phi. OK, so let me write the algorithm. So I consider a spheres. Then the first thing is that I set the initial radii I call the radii that change in time, because I would like to move phi, small ri. So at time zero, there will be some fraction gamma of the target radii, okay? And gamma is less than one. And for example, you can start with gamma zero equal to zero, okay? So in this case, you just get point-like particles. So this, if I get point-like particles, whatever random assignment of the configuration, I get a satisfiable solution to the problem, right? And then what do I do? OK, so I start with this. I initialize at random the initial positions for my spheres. And then I start to run Newton dynamics, okay? So those are hard spheres, they will collide. So how do we do? So I take the initial positions and then I assign some random velocity to each sphere. So this will set a kind of temperature scale. For our spheres, temperature has no real meaning, but it's just a scale, a time scale. And then, so those spheres will start to move and they will collide. And when they collide, they just resolve collision elastically. Okay, so this is just Newton dynamics. And then, when I do this, I start to increase gamma of t very slowly. Okay, so this is like some cooling of your system, but instead of cooling the system, you're just compressing the system very slowly, because I'm starting increasing the radii very slowly. Okay. Now, this is interesting because, so if you do this very slowly, you can start to write some phase diagram. And I will write the phase diagram here. So this is the algorithm. So In order to track its evolution, we would like to plot, for example, as a function of the packing fraction that now is a function of gamma. What you can do is that you can start to plot the pressure of the system, or 1 over the pressure, okay? So those spheres are inside the box, they collide with the box, and so you have a pressure on the boundary, which you can measure, okay? As essentially the amount of collisions that you get on the boundary. So if the packing fraction is small, you expect that the pressure is very small. So this is very large. And of course, if you increase the packing fraction, so when you increase gamma, the pressure will increase. Okay. So here, at low phi, what you can observe is that the system is a kind of gas that is able to explore its phase space in a kind of simple way. So you have here a gas. Actually, we call it a liquid just because, I mean, we think, okay. It's not a liquid because in order to have a liquid, you need to have an attractive part in your interaction potential. But okay, it's like a liquid. And then when you increase it, so when you increase phi, at some point, you have a first order transition. For example, let me consider d equal 3, which is now crucial. So you have a first order transition, which is a crystallization transition. So at this point here, so we have C plus. You form a crystal, okay, an FCC crystal, if I take the particles that are monodispersed. And then if I have this crystal, I compress the crystal, and here I get the FCC lattice, okay? So it's the densest packing in 3D for monodispersed spheres. Now, so if you are in higher dimensions, already 4 is quite good. Or if you take a polydispersed system, you essentially kill the nucleation of the crystal. So finding a crystal is something that it's tricky, because in phase space, you need to find the right configuration. And as soon as you increase the dimension, this increases the phase space volume. And so finding the crystal becomes more and more complicated. So in these other situations, essentially this part of the curve you will never see on reasonable time scales. And what you will see is that this curve continues a bit more. And at some point, there is a point here, okay, that I will call phi glass. Okay, 1 over p glass. Where essentially, if here you have a kind of liquid system, so the shear modulus is 0, here you start to see a shear modulus. So you have a glass transition, and here you have a glass phase. Okay, so this is glass. So I should do it with another color, maybe. So this glass point is, so there is a phase before in which essentially the system is said to be super cooled. Okay, so you have this phase here. So if you take d equal 3 and you take a monodispersed system, you can also avoid, for example, the crystalline phase by compressing the system a bit faster. And there is a region here which is called super cooled. But the important point is that at some point, if you avoid this crystalline part, you enter in a phase which is kind of metastable with respect to the crystal, if you find the crystal, if there is a crystal there. And at some point, this face becomes a glass face. So in the end, you get a configuration, an amorphous configuration of spheres, which is solid. Okay. So this is a glass. And the point in which you become solid depends on gamma. Okay. So the faster you compress the system, the sooner you become solid. Okay, so I don't know if I have more colors, but yes. So if, for example, if I take gamma of t to increase very slowly, I get a glass a bit farther in phi, okay? Now, as soon as I get a glass, I leave this equilibrium curve, and as soon as I'm trapped in a glass and I compress this glass, I'll start to go down, okay? The pressure increases, and then at some point I cannot compress this glass anymore because the pressure diverges. I get a kind of close packed structure, and this is, again, a jamming transition, okay? So it separates a region where I'm able to find configuration of R-spheres that do not overlap. And of course, if I'm using R-sphere, I cannot go beyond, so I cannot make the spheres overlap. And this jamming transition now depends on the rate at which you are compressing. So if you take the glass that was created at this point, I will get another jamming density, okay? So this is phi j of gamma, okay?
Yes?
Yeah, if you take monodispersed, for example, d equal 5, so the crystalline side you never see, so on reasonable time scales, and you see this. Yes?
In the limit case, when I set gamma very quickly, we have the right curve.
Yeah, so if gamma is increases very fast, you have the left curve. So the glass point, the glass transition point arrives before, because essentially you have not given time to the system to explore the phase space. Very slowly, you go here, so you get a glass transition a bit far away, a bit farther from.
There is a limit for how much slowly I can change gamma.
To do what?
I mean, if I set gamma very small.
Yes.
There is a limit when that I can have a glass transition.
So if okay, so all this at this point is kind of heuristic. Now, how do you have to tune gamma in order to push this transition far away or okay, to push this transition far away depends on how do you describe this glass face here? And this, for this, we don't have any description. I mean, theoretical one in finite dimension, but we have in infinite dimension. So what happens in infinite dimension is that you have a sharp transition. Okay, I was trying to say, okay, maybe I'll say it now. So this is what you essentially observe if you run this algorithm. And now you can do the infinity. So what happens in the, yes?
This is not an isotherm, is it?
Sorry?
Is that an isotherm? No.
Well, it's for our spheres, it's, I mean, the temperature plays no role, so it's just a microscopic time scale. So here, everything is entropic, because as soon as you have our spheres, sorry? So the dynamics slows down as soon as you arrive at this point. So, okay, so Okay, this I was not going to say anything, but maybe I'll say something. So when you do this compression, essentially you observe that when you are here, the time it takes to reach some stationary state, which is equilibrium-like. So here you can show that this algorithm, if gamma is small enough, can give you a Gibbs measure. So the time it takes to reach this equilibrium distribution is finite. But then when you increase the packing fraction, the dynamics slows down. So the time it takes to reach this equilibrium curve increases. And in particular, when you arrive at the glass transition point, the time is so large that you do not have time to wait in your simulation to see the relaxation. Okay, so here it's a kind of experimental glass transition point because it's determined by the time scale at which your relaxation time scale exceeds some threshold that you fix from your experiment. Okay, and it's very large. Okay, so in infinite dimension you can have this picture a bit precise. But I'm not, I'm saying something a bit later, but I just, so what happens in infinite dimension is that you can plot this curve, and I will tell you a bit how, as a function of the packing fraction. And in particular, this glass transition region here, that here depends on gamma, becomes a sharp point here that we call a dynamical glass transition or mode coupling transition that is a sharp transition in only in infinite dimension. And above this point, you can show that you have here a glass phase. So your equilibrium measure, so what's the Gibbs measure that you have here, when you cross this point, splits in an exponential number of ergodic components, and I will describe them a bit later. And then here you are, you can take different glasses at different packing fractions, and then you can compress them. Okay. So in infinite dimension, I mean, gamma is important in the sense that if you take the gamma to zero limit, so infinite is low compression, you have anyway a transition, which is this dynamical transition, above which you cannot go on time scales that are finite. So if you wait exponential time scales, you can equilibrate this part of the phase diagram, but this, okay, you don't, okay. So this picture can be kind of made precise in infinite dimension. But okay, so I will come back a bit later on this. I just wanted to point out here that this algorithm tells you one thing, which is that this jamming density, that is the density at which my algorithm is not able to find a satisfiable assignment for my constraint satisfaction problem, really depends on the algorithm. So if I change gamma, I get different phi j. So in particular here, I have a jamming line. Okay, so I don't know. So this is a jamming line. Okay, so, and in particular, if you really do fast compression and you avoid this crystalline branch, you end up with jamming densities that are essentially the same as gradient descent. Okay, so very fast, greedy algorithms stop to find satisfiable configurations at those densities that are kind of numerical extrapolation of data. But of course, if you do more involved algorithms that try to look at phase space, try to look more carefully at phase space regions where you can find solutions, you can get satisfiable assignments also at higher densities. Okay. Okay, so I think this way to think about this problem is interesting because think from this point of view, you start really from a kind of mathematical question, and then you end up with some phase diagram that is some physics phase diagram. And the physics is in the algorithm. Okay, yes. Yes.
And how you do that? If you look at the Lagrangian distribution, then how you compute this pressure?
Well, you just, if you put the particles in a box, you just look at the amount of moment that is transferred to the boundaries. Just the basic definition of pressure. So the particles will collide with the boundary.
Newton
exactly, yes. And do Newton dynamics. Okay, so the outcome of this is that this jamming density depends on the algorithm in general. So the precise value of ij is algorithm dependent. But it turns out that a lot of properties of packings at jamming are independent of the algorithm. And this is a kind of experimental numerical observation. So what are those properties?
And
yes.
Is it possible? Do you say something about what happens to the crystal at infinite dimension?
No. We don't have there is no theory for the crystal in infinite dimension. So this is really an important problem, and it's unclear if there is a crystal. So more people believe that in infinite dimension, the densest packing gas is actually non-crystalline, but there is no theory for that. And it's very active field of research now. Okay, so this branch, we don't see in infinite dimension, there is no theory for it. Okay, so the properties of packings at jamming are kind of universal, and let me tell you what are those universal properties. So when I mean universal, it means that they do not depend on the preparation of your packing. So whatever algorithm you use, you get these properties. And that's it. So it's really some set of observations that hold for whatever algorithm you choose. Okay, so So there are two sets of universal properties. One I will not talk about it. And I will mostly talk about universal microstructural properties of packings, which means that I will try to look at the statistics of configurations of spheres at jamming. So what are those properties? So the first one is isostaticity. So if you look at a packing at jamming, what you can look at is the number of degrees of freedom that you have, which scales like the total number of particles that you have times the dimension of your system. Now I call small d the dimension. Before I was calling capital D the dimension, but let me just call it small d the dimension of the system. And then what happens is that this number is equal to the number of contacts. So what I mean by contacts is I mean pairs of spheres that barely touch. Okay. So what does it mean? So let me assume that, okay, let me look at the contact network here. Okay, so I link pairs of spheres that are in contact, and I look at the degree, the average degree of the network. So how many spheres are in contact with the neighbors? Okay, so if I take a sphere, I count the number of spheres that are in contact with the sphere, and then I take the average of this number. And I call it Z. So the number of contacts is Z times N divided by 2. Why? Because each sphere is in contact with Z spheres on average. Then I multiply it by N. And then this means that I'm counting each link twice. And then I need to divide it by 2. So this will give me the number of links that I have in my packet. And so this thing, which is what you find if you run a simulation, tells you that this is equal to this, which means that the average degree of this contact network is equal to 2 times the dimension. Okay. Okay, so this is what is found in all, I would call, local algorithms that try to produce configurations of spheres at the jamming point. If you do some non-local algorithm or algorithms that involve movements of particles that are kind of extended, you may end up with different behavior here. But all local algorithms produce configurations that satisfy this property. Now, what does it mean, this? So, okay, how do you understand this? So, what is a contact? So a contact is an equation. Why? Because a contact is a pair of spheres such that its gap is equal to zero. So if I have sphere I here, and sphere j that is here, then a contact is just this equation, okay? So what this relation is telling you is that the number of equations that you have in your system is exactly equal to the number of degrees of freedom. And so if you have this condition, you can find a solution to this set of equations, okay? So as soon as Z is less than 2D, then this system is underdetermined, okay? So you have a, so this is a system of equations, because you have this equation for all pair of spheres I and j that belongs to, let me call, the contact network, which is just the set of pairs of spheres that are in contact. So as soon as Z is less than 2D, then the system is said to be floppy, meaning that you have many solutions to this problem, which means that the system can move, okay? Because if I have many solutions, I can change the position of a sphere without making some of them overlap, okay? And then if Z is greater than 2D, then this is, okay, how do you say? So in this case, you said that the system is hypostatic. And here you say that it's hyperstatic. So what does it mean? It means that here you have many more equations that are satisfied. So your configuration is a rather non-trivial one, because if I remove an equation, then I still get the same solution. So note that these equations are nonlinear, because if I look at the form of hij, this is a nonlinear function. Okay, so what you see in numerical simulations is that you never find this, okay, you find this solution, this configuration for phi less than phi j. For example, if you do gradient descent, because you end up with pairs of spheres that are barely touching at the end of the gradient descent, but you don't find this hyperstatic configuration. And when you go to jamming, you always find this condition. And note that this condition is at the verge between the two. So if I reach this point, I have a number of constraints that is exactly the one that I need to have in order to have just one solution of my problem. OK, so that's the first thing. So the second thing, I don't know how much time I have. Half an hour, OK, good. So once you have this this structure, what you can do is that you can look at what happens between pairs of spheres. So imagine that I have a configuration of jamming. What I can look at is the force distribution. So imagine that I give you a configuration. Now again, it's R spheres. I put those R spheres inside a box, so they are jammed. And now I start to compress the box. So what will happen is that you will have a contact force network that will spread all over the system. Because if I'm compressing the system, I cannot do it. So there will be contact forces that will act against my compression. So you can measure those forces. And you can make the histogram. Okay. So if you look at them, so you look at the distribution of contact forces, and what you can observe is that this distribution looks like this. And in particular, if you look at what happens at zero or small contact forces, you start to see that P of F has some power law behavior, okay, characterized by some critical exponent theta. Now, I will call this exponent a critical exponent. It's not a critical exponent in the sense of renormalization group for the moment, but I will tell you that it's a critical exponent because it controls all the properties of avalanches that you have in the system, okay? And it will come. So the idea of the lectures is that at the end, the computation of this exponent here will come from some kind of scaling analysis of the theory. Okay, so it's not a critical exponent as in the sense of coarse graining and standard RG, but it's a solution of some scaling problem. Okay, yes. Okay, the word critical exponent can be used for, but here I think it's really critical exponent because you are at a critical point, this jamming point. Yet the way in which you get it, it's not with standard RG methods. It's an RG. I will try to argue that it's a kind of RG, but some strange form that I will try to describe. And okay, so that's what you observe. It's
how do you calculate
the difference? Okay, I do compute the forces. So one way is just okay, so there is one way that is a bit involved, I mean just technically, but there is another Okay, how do I measure those forces? So let me, for a moment, let me forget our spheres. So imagine that I take harmonics of spheres. So how to measure the forces? So imagine that I take harmonics of spheres. So again, just to remind, harmonics of spheres are like this. And now let me assume that I approach. So I approach the jamming point from the ansatz side. So I'm a little bit above jamming. So I have spheres that barely overlap. Okay. And so since they overlap, there is a fraction of the Hij that are negative. Okay. And then I look at the behavior of this system as soon as I go towards unjamming. And I define the forces, so Fij, so the force between particle I and j, as the absolute value of Hij as soon as this is negative, divided by the average of this, so the average of Hij. So this has a well-defined limit when I go to unjamming. Why? Because these things are going to zero. But if I normalize with the average is going to zero too. And so the ratio is going to be a finite number. Okay? So this is positive when phi goes to phi j plus. Okay? So this is a really practical way to compute this object. So you take harmonics of spheres, you decompress up to the jamming point, and you compute these things. You can also do some procedure for our spheres, but OK. So this is really the simplest thing that you can do. OK, so this is the one thing. So we have isostaticity, this behavior of the forces. OK, just one word more. Why this is important, this is interesting, and why we care about this exponent? We care about this exponent because imagine that I have a packing. So this is isostatic. So I have just enough constraints in the system to have a configuration that is mechanically stable. And now imagine that I put some dipolar force somewhere in the system. So I perturb this packing in some way. So I take two spheres and I apply some dipolar force. This will correspond to removing one of these constraints. And this will create some kind of excitation in the system, a floppy mode, because now the system is a bit hypostatic. And so the system can move. And in particular, if I have a lot of very small forces, I can make the system move very easily. Because if I take the contacts that carry the smallest force, it's there where the system will be able to move far away from the position where it is now. So controlling small forces is a way to understand how the system behaves when I perturb it. Okay. So and indeed, what I will argue is that this critical exponent is really crucial to understand all the properties of avalanches in this system. OK, so this is what happens for forces. And the last thing that you have is that you can look at the gap distribution. So we looked at the pairs of spheres that are in contact, but you can also look at pairs of spheres that are not in contact, that are nearby. So you look at the distribution of positive H, okay? So this you can, once you have the packing, you can measure all the gaps. And for positive gaps, what you find is that this has something, this has a power law divergence here, and then something else, okay? So you have an abundance of pairs of spheres that are almost touching, okay? So why this is interesting? Because, so we say that if we apply some dipolar force on two pairs of spheres that carry a very small force, this will create a floppy mode. So this will make the system soft under this kind of nonlinear excitations. And since the system is soft, it's very unstable. So you need a mechanism that is able to stabilize the configurations. And what is the mechanism? So if you have an abundance of very small gaps, it may happen that when you excite this floppy mode, at some point, some of a pair of spheres that was barely touching, under the evolution of the soft mode, will touch. So you will create a new contact, which will stabilize the system. So the competition between this and this, plus isostaticity, really controls the properties, the mechanical properties of those packings. Okay. And you have all those properties regardless the local algorithm that you use to find a configurational gem. So those properties are universal, and they control the breakdown of elasticity in this system. Why the breakdown? Because we will see that when you perturb the systems, the rearrangements are kind of avalanches. And you can compute the distribution of avalanches, and this is related to those exponents. Okay. Okay, so I have 20
minutes.
20 minutes, okay. Good.
Did you have a quick question?
Yes.
Can you think of G or P, for instance, as a function of, for instance, for P of F and the distance to isostaticity?
Yes.
And write down the power law, as Jim was mentioning today.
Yes, okay, so, yeah. Yes, you can think about it this way, and actually that's what happens in the sense that, so what I will, sorry? So the question is, can you think about those curves with the distance from isostaticity? So in particular, what you can imagine is that if you are far away from isostaticity, this is something like this. And then if you go closer and closer to isostaticity, there is this thing that goes up to here. And the same is here. Okay, so you have some kind of finite crossover. And then as soon as you go to isostaticity, that you get a pure power law because you are at the critical point. Now this you can get. And it's not really, okay, so you have some measure on the distance of from isostaticity, but I will argue that the scaling form that you have, it's in a kind of different space. So this thing will be connected. OK, I'm just saying something for that is really for the last lecture. So this distribution for the forces, you get as a kind of a scaling limit in which you start from a glass. And in the glass, particles move as some kind of cage. And then when you compress, this cage size shrinks to zero. Okay, so if you can think that the isostaticity limit is the point where the cage has gone to zero, because if I'm a sphere, I'm just blocked. I cannot vibrate. So if I look at the system a little bit before, so when I have still a bit of possibility to move, there is some scale invariance there. So if you rescale the space around you with the distance from the critical point, you have a scaling regime. So you can get some universal scaling function there. But this is, I mean, in order to control this, you need to control the distribution of jamming points, so the microstructural configurations in phase space. So how, so, okay, this I didn't say probably too much, but so, of course, the configuration that you get here is amorphous. So if I take another instance of the problem, for example, initialize the particles in a different way, I get a different configuration. So in order to get this power loss, you need to understand how those configurations are located in phase space somehow, and how the phase space behaves when you reach continuously this this jamming point. So this, so in the end, you're right. So there will be some scaling function that tells you how this behaves in this region here. And actually, the scaling function is very interesting. So there is a scaling equation that it's an ODE that that one can solve. Okay, so okay, so I gave you all these properties. There is a last property that is that maybe I will tell you. Okay, very fast, because I will not focus on probably on this. So so one thing that you can look at is, and this is from the unsat side of the transition, so on the dense part of the phase diagram. So imagine again that you have harmonics of spheres. So you take harmonics of spheres for phi slightly larger than phi j. Okay, so phi j plus. So if I look at a configuration at zero temperature, this is a local minimum of the of my potential energy, okay? And I can look at the Hessian in this local minimum. So I have some positions for the spheres that minimize the gradient, so. So this is a local minimum of my Hamiltonian. And then I can look at the Hessian. So alpha and beta are d-dimensional indices. Okay. And since the configuration that I have is a kind of amorphous configuration, this is a random matrix. And I can look at the spectrum of this matrix. Okay, so they will, in the large n limit, this will take smooth form, and actually people used to plot it, so people are used to make this change of variable from eigenvalues to eigenfrequencies, and call this d of omega. And when you plot it, so let me put, for example, logarithmic scale in omega. What you observe is something like this. So this is approaching the jamming point from the unsat side. So there is a plateau that is developing. And in the jamming limit, you get just something that is flat at omega equal to zero. So,
Pier Francesco, just to make sure, this is the density of states, right? And
yes.
Okay, okay. And you calculate it from the eigenvalues of the Hessian. Okay.
Yes. So you just look at the Hessian, you look at the eigenvalues, you look at the density of states, and this, it has a flat behavior at zero frequency. So you have an abundance of very soft excitations. And this is very different from a crystal where, so if you look at regular crystals, the omega scales like omega d minus 1. This is just the bylaw. Okay. So all this tell you that if you look at these packings at jamming, they are kind of marginally stable. In the sense that from all point of view, they are really at the boundary between some stable phase and an unstable phase. So for example, here, the isostaticity condition is some condition that tells you that you are stable but barely stable. You have an abundance of very soft linear excitations. And if you look to force and gap distribution, they are related in some way that tells you that, you are close to an instability point, but the instability is kind of prevented by the distribution of gaps. Okay. Okay. So I didn't give you references, but all this comes from a lot of work of really great people. And isostaticity and the density of states is already in the first paper by Wern, Liu, Nagel, and Silber. And the force and gap distributions were highlighted by some work by Mathieu Viard and collaborators. So just a bit of references. So isostaticity. Plus d of omega is already in the paper that I mentioned by Oern et al. Then there is a series of papers on those things. So I think that one of the first was Lerner during MVR 2013. And then there is another work by, I can write here. So it's Charbonneau. Corwin, Paris, and Zamponi. And it's 2012. Actually, I think this appeared, I think, before, but I'm not completely sure. And there is another work in 2015. And I measured those exponents. Okay, so this one is roughly 0.42. This one is 0.41 something. Okay. So actually, on this one, there are some subtleties, in the sense that you can show that the distribution of forces, if you just don't do your statistical analysis in a blind way, doesn't follow this number, because you have some people call them bucklers, that are particles that are connected in a kind of atypical way. And this atypicality you see if you are in low enough dimension. But if you take, for example, so in infinite dimension, you don't see this atypical behavior. And if you do, you remove from your analysis these atypical particles, you get this number. Okay, and this is what we can get from infinite dimension. Okay, and I want to just say another thing, because maybe I thought about the exercise session as a kind of session which I can say something more, but we will see how it goes. So, and what I wanted to mention, if you are interested, is that there is a very nice work by Mathieu Viard, where essentially he connects this problem to some spinless problem, and he derives a scaling relation between this exponent and the exponent gamma. Okay, and this relation is based on the assumption that you have isostaticity, which you can argue that you must have. And it comes out as a kind of bound. So actually, he derives a bound that tells you that gamma must be greater or equal than 1 over 2 plus theta. And then he assumes that marginal stability is satisfied, which means that this bound is saturated. Okay. So you get a scaling relation between gamma and theta. And numerically, this scaling relation is very well verified. And if we do the computation in infinite dimension, we get the precise, the bound is saturated. Okay. So in infinite dimension, we get a saturation of the bound. Okay, so so what I would like to do is to tell you how we can make a theory of this, a mean field theory of this in infinite dimension. And so the way in which I will try to do this is to first give you a kind of historical perspective on the construction of the theory of the Gemini transition in the limit of infinite dimension for real spheres. But this I will not do in detail. I will tell you what's the main idea. And then what I will try to do is to instead map this problem to a more abstract problem that is a constraint satisfaction problem. That's why I started this thing from constraint satisfaction. This abstract problem is much easier to solve because you have some quench disorder in the system. Here, there is no quench disorder. If I take a monodisperse system in D equal 5, there is no quench disorder. The disorder in the amorphous packing is self-generated by the algorithm. So there is an important theoretical problem that is how you make a theory for amorphous system without quench disorder, which is something that took a long time and a lot of clever people to derive. So it's a bit more complicated to do a theory for particles without quench disorder, but I will take the constraint satisfaction perspective to use some simpler model that has quench disorder, and this will allow me to solve it a bit faster. So the idea is to go from this problem and all these properties to a simpler problem that is more abstract and try to solve this simpler problem and tell you how this P of F and G of H appear in this problem. Okay, so I think, I don't know how much time I have. 5 minutes. Okay, so I think it's very good point to stop. And okay, if you have questions.
Questions? Let's thank the speaker before the question.
Thank you very much for the lecture. I would like to ask you about the force distribution. Mm-hmm. Is there a particular reason why this is, in my view, asymmetric, this distribution?
What do you mean by asymmetric? I mean, this is something that is defined only on the positive side, and there is no reason to have any symmetry.
Yes, like
from the maximum. But the maximum, like, it can be
shifted.
It can be shifted, and it depends on the algorithm that you use. I mean, this form is not universal at all. What is universal is this behavior here.
Oh, okay.
But the shape of this curve is something that depends on the algorithm that you use, on the jamming points that you look at, and there is no universality in this part. But here, yes. So this this critical exponent is universal. So actually, I want to say something. Thanks for the question, because so I told you all this for hard spheres or soft spheres, harmonic soft spheres at jamming, and you can extend all this if you do linear spheres. That is what I was mentioning before. So imagine that you take V of H. That is this. So I pay some cost which is linear in the gap. So this is what is called inch loss in machine learning. And it's used to train support vector machines. And okay, from purely physical point of view, I mean, it's hard to believe that you have some system with this kind of interaction potential, but you can still play the game of looking at local minimum of this interaction potential. And this is something that we did recently with Silvio Franz, Antonio Sclocchi, and myself. So imagine that you look at phi greater than phi j, so you take a dense system, and then you look at the local minimum of this interaction potential. Okay, and what you realize is that since you have this linear thing, so the form of this V of H is something like this. So you have zero here, and then something like this. So when you try to minimize, you will have some gaps that will get stuck precisely in this point. So if you look at a snapshot of of a local minimum of this potential, you will start to see something like this. So there are pairs of spheres that just touch. And then there are also pairs of spheres that overlap. So you will have both a contact network and overlaps. And then you look at the properties of the contact network. And the contact network is again isostatic. So if you look at the number of contacts, this is exactly equal to the number of degrees of freedom. But you are above jamming, so the energy is positive. Some of the spheres will overlap. And then you can play again the same game as a jamming. So you can look at the distribution of contact forces and gaps. And here, OK, so for this system, you have that P of F. It's something like this. So you see that here you can have. So when I'm here in this region, the force is 1. Because if I take the derivative of this, I just get a constant. So I can have forces only between 0 and 1. And all the forces that are 1 are essentially overlaps. Okay. So all contacts can carry a force that is bounded between 0 and 1, which is the slope of this function. So if you look at the P of F, you get something like this. So here is 1. So it's not, in general, it's not symmetric. And it depends on the density. So you get, now you get 2 power laws. Which are controlled by 2 critical exponents. And it turns out that the 2 critical exponents are the same, numerically, and equal to this one. And we can make a mean field theory for this, which is a more complicated version of the thing that I'm going to describe in the next lectures. So if you look at this curve, this is just to come back to your question, this is not symmetric at all. And it really depends on the density. For example, if you are close to jamming, you expect that this part here is somehow suppressed, because I mean, this part comes from pairs of spheres that would like to become some overlap. And of course, these pairs of spheres you don't have as soon as you go towards jamming. So if you are close to jamming, this curve will behave like this. So, okay. And then if you compress the system a bit more, you get something which is more symmetric and so on. So the shape of the curve is not universal at all. What is universal is the behavior of the edges. Yes. For harmonic soft spheres, well, you typically see some Gaussian decay there. Okay, sorry, harmonic soft spheres. Yes, sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Yeah, the Gaussian decay. Okay, so, I mean, above jamming. I'm sorry. So if you are at jamming and you do the rescaling, then this is you get something like it can be broad. And actually, it's well fitted by some exponential form, a Gaussian form, typical Gaussian. But this part is what enters in force chain and so on. So I will not look at this part. I will mostly focus on this part.
More questions?
It's tight.
Thanks. What do you assume about the probability distribution of the radii?
The polystyrene. I mean, they are not very important. I mean, as soon as you fix them, once for all, and you don't do anything with them, either you take a monodisperse system. And you are in high enough dimension, you compress your system very fast. Or you take a polydispersed system, those distributions have always the same universal shape around the origin. So the distribution of radii is not very important for the critical properties. So they enter in the shape of the distribution, but this is not universal anyway. So the shape of the distribution depends on everything, on the jamming density, the algorithm. No, not on the radii. So the shape, yes, depends on the radii, but not this thing. So the prefactor of this thing can depend on the distribution, but not this. So that's what is observed. And within the theory, there is a way to understand it. So there is really scale invariance appearing and
more questions? Okay, let's thank Pier Francesco again.
Thank you.
We'll have a break for lunch, and we'll be back at 2:30 p.m. Okay?